Hi, and welcome to this series where I'm going to be going through a number of IT management approaches, methodologies, activities, and practices. And I'll be giving you the main headline points and the base foundation knowledge that you need to know. I'll also discuss some of my real-world applications of these activities and practices in the various organisations I've worked in. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel, like, and click the bell for those updates. Okay, so let's get to it. Today I'm going to be starting off a series where I'm going to be covering off the key concepts around service integration and management, abbreviated to SIAM. So in terms of key concepts that you need to know when you're thinking through SIAM, there's a number of them. So you've got the SIAM layers, and I should say, as I go through the various key concepts, I'm going to be doing other videos that will cover each one of those individual key concepts in a little more detail. But the first item is around the SIAM layers, and then we talk about the SIAM structures, and then the drivers for SIAM. Why would you do SIAM? Why do organisations do it? What is the driver behind that? And then we'll talk around some of the terminology around the SIAM practice, the SIAM function, the SIAM roles. There's a variety of different roles. Structural elements, we'll talk about those. And also the different types of SIAM models, and then the roadmap as well. So if we briefly just talk about the SIAM layers here, that there are three layers. You have a customer, you have a service integrator, and you have a service provider layer. And at the service provider layer, typically there'll be lots of different types of service providers. Now, if you split those out, they split into three areas quite nicely. So the customer organization bit, so that's typically looking from the strategic level. So you can align strategy to the customer organization layer. And then when you come to service integrator, you can look at the key word there being integrator. There's an integration element that is needed from that strategy. So if the customer's telling you what the strategy is, there's an integration element that needs to be put into place, and that's the role of the service integrator. And then you've got the delivery element, which is the service provider. So you'll have a whole bunch of service providers, perhaps some of them are even internal service providers, but you will have a collection of different service providers, and that's the delivery, that's the execution, that's where it's happening. So you've got those three layers. You've got the customer organization layer, which is the strategic element. You have the service integrator layer, which is your integration layer, and then the service provider layer, which is the delivery element of that. Within the customer organization, it's worth pointing out at that top layer you also have something called retained capabilities or functions, and those are the retained capability that within a SIAM model, the customer may say, we want to hang on to these, we want to look after, and then there'll be a list of areas or functions. In my experience, and certainly SIAM documentation talks about this, is anything governance, anything oversight typically falls into a retained capability function, business engagement as well. Architecture, especially enterprise architecture, is one of those areas that it's not unusual for that to be retained. Likewise, strategic. So we've already said the customer organization has that strategy layer. So anything strategic, not unusual to see that as a retained capability. Procurement can be a retained capability. I've worked in a number of SIAM operating models, and I've seen procurement both from a retained capability element, but also being pushed outside of the customer as well. But certainly procurement is an area. Risk is another area that you would see as a retained capability typically. especially anything enterprise-wise. So enterprise risk, as an example. And then any contractual activities, any contractual management, CM-type work, would typically be a retained capability. The service integrator, so this is the integration layer. That's about the collaboration. That's the orchestration. It's the end-to-end piece. That's the element where the integration begins. And the service provider, so that's the execution, the delivery of whatever that may be. Perhaps it's support or hosting activity, whatever it may be. And also remember, when you talk about service providers, don't always assume service providers and the delivery element is an external relationship. It can be an internal service provider as well. So the role of the customer organization, it's about setting the direction based on the organization's vision, the direction, the strategy that it's going in. Previously, the sort of the multi-service provider model, you would have the customer organization managing those relationships with each individual service provider. Now, if you don't have many service providers, that's fine. However, if you have lots of service providers, it becomes really complex really quickly. Lots of monthly service reviews, lots of escalations, lots of people pointing fingers in different directions as to, yeah, this isn't my problem, this is the other service provider, it's the P1 that's going on at the moment. No, that's going off to another, that's the networking layer rather than the application layer. It can become quite difficult to manage lots of different direct relationships with lots of different service providers. Q, the SIAM model, that's where the organization then has a relationship just with a single party, which is the service integrator. It's worthy of note, of course, the customer still has that contractual relationship with the service providers, but the service integrator is doing the QA, the coordination, making all the service providers play nicely together, put in place a collaborative environment. And again, just finally around the customer organization layer, that retained capability. Those are elements that the customer will say, we want to hang on to those. They go by lots of different names. Intelligent client function is an example I've heard previously, but mainly I've heard them as retained capability, and that's your governance and your architecture and procurement and enterprise risk and contract management, etc. Okay, so in terms of the service integrator, they are responsible for managing the service providers. They provide the ecosystem, and then they make sure that everybody plays nicely across that ecosystem, that there's a collaborative approach, that all the service providers are integrated, and that the service integrator provides that assurance, that end-to-end service element, providing value. So they're providing the delivery, but just as important, providing the value as well. So the service integrator, they're responsible for managing the service providers, and they provide that collaborative environment over the ecosystem. Another point just to really be aware of in terms of the different types of service integrators, you can have an internal integrator, and you can have an external integrator, and you can also have a combination of the two. Interestingly, I've worked in both the internal environment and the external environment. Each has its pluses and minuses. So finally, just let's focus on the service providers. So it's unusual you'll just have one service provider. An ecosystem, a SIAM ecosystem, will typically have lots of service providers. And it's not unusual for a customer to have that as one of those drivers as to why would you look at SIAM is because it becomes very difficult to manage those direct relationships all the time with all of those different service providers. Each service provider is responsible for their part in the contracted service. So it's really important that the service integrator reiterates the point around a collaborative environment, an end-to-end environment, trying to avoid that situation where you have a service provider pointing to another service provider and saying, well, it's not my problem, it's theirs. And then that service provider saying, well, it's not my problem, it's someone else's. The service integrator skill is about getting all these service providers to work together, to play nicely together, and to support that collaborative approach. It's not working for the customer. How do we get it working? And I mentioned earlier as well, you can have an external service provider that may be another organization, another vendor, another third party. Perhaps those were pre-existing external service providers, or they may well have been brought in by the service integrator. And then you can have internal service providers. And that could be, say, an application team, for the sake of argument, an application support team that was part of the customer's organization. So part of the skill for a service integrator is managing service providers, but a big point there is that some of those service providers could well be internal teams. It could be an internal development team. It could be an internal application team. Those are real world examples I've come across. The final point I'll leave you with around service providers is the service integrator should then assess each service provider and have a level of criteria as to, okay, who are the organizations, the service providers that provide the most amount of service or the least amount of service, or the areas that are the most impact or the middle impact or the least impact, whatever it may be. But make sure there's an element of categorizing into either strategical, tactical, operational, commodity base, or value, whatever it may be, but there needs to be an element of just making sure that you're able to split them out. Typically, strategically, tactically, and commodity based is a good way of looking at those, and then apply the level of management and governance and oversight accordingly. Okay, thank you very much. Please do subscribe. I'll continue to post information, and I will be covering the next key concepts that you need to be aware of when it comes to SIAM. Once again, please do subscribe.